Okay. Okay, there we go. Hello everybody, my name is Steffi and I work at Etsy. Today I'm gonna show you a fun way to work with your input. I'm speaking about parsers. So why parsers, could you ask? Isn't that only relevant when I'm writing a compiler? I'm a web developer, why should I even care about this? Why is this interesting for me? Let's scratch that question and ask an even more existential question. What even is a computer program? A computer program is a file that contains code that can be run with a computer. Duh. From the outside, a computer program is a black box. It gets an input, it does something, and it generates an output. It could be a file that tells the web server what to display, or it could be a command line application. And I make the claim that a parser might be hiding in your program. Let's get that parser out of the dark. But first of all, why am I claiming that there's a parser hiding in your program? What was a parser again? A parser is a function that transforms a sequence of input, for example, a string of characters, just a string, into a data structure. And the data structure reflects the structure of the input string. It might already give us some hints on its meaning and show us the structure of the problem specification for our program. So this data structure is called a parse tree. Even though not every program constructs such a tree when reading the input, it's implicitly there. So we could build and print it if we wanted to examine it. So let's have a look. An example tree for a mathematical expression could look like this. So I have here 9 minus 5 plus 2, and the tree would look like this. And a fun thing to note here is that if we read the leaves of the tree, we could get the input string back. This is called the yield of the tree, that stuff that grows on a tree. But from the shape of the tree, we also know the underlying structure. We know that we have to do this 9 minus 5 thing first somehow. So how does the parser know which kind of tree to generate from an input string? That's totally up to us, the programmers. It's our decision. We define what kind of input our program accepts or what kind of input causes it to fail. So 9 plus minus, minus plus, I don't know what to do. We decide about the underlying structure of the input when we write our program. Most of the time we're not thinking about this. So how can we express it? How can we express the structure of our input? We can express the underlying structure of the input with a grammar. Like in natural language, where the grammar describes the sentence structure, when I'm saying a sentence like, hello, I'm Steffi and I work at Etsy. So if we would write down the elements of our tree after parsing our little math expression, we would notice something. Let's just look at the tree for 1 second. So the internal nodes, they are always called the same thing. They're always called list and digit. And the leaves are either digits or plus or minus somewhere there in the tree. Let's write these elements down to find the hidden rules which express how our tree is constructed. So if we see that again. A list goes to a list plus digit, or a list minus digit, or a digit. Top row, right? And then the bottom row, a digit goes to a digit. It's easy. So we deduce two rules. Let's write them as rules. They would look more like this, maybe. On the left of the arrow, there are the internal nodes, list and digit. And on the right are all possible children constellations of these internal nodes. And because it's really hard to make these little tree snippets readable by a computer, we could just write it in a string notation. So away with all these branches, and it should look like this. Something like this. B and F to the rescue. So these guys are John Backus and Peter Knorr, giving the name to the Backus-Knorr form from which we just almost used. And it's a standardized way to write the rules that we just found out. John Backus is the inventor of Fortran, formula translator, and it's the first high-level computing language. And Peter Knorr is one of the inventors of Algol 60. So these are some dinosaurs of computer science. So we were here, and B and F would now look pretty similar. Would look like this. And all variants of the B and F have the same elements. So we are building grammar rules here. There are two of them here, one for list and one for digit. And each rule explains how to construct a small piece of the abstract syntax tree. On the left side of each rule, there's a word in angle brackets. These words are called non-terminal symbols, and they indicate we are not done yet building our tree. And they correspond to the internal nodes of the final tree, if that makes sense. And this double colon equals follows here, weird symbol, which is read as is defined as. On the right side of each rule, there are alternatives, and they are delimited by a bar, which is read as or. So the first rule would read as list is defined as list plus digit, or list minus digit, or digit, like we said. On the right side of the rule, each alternative consists of a sequence of words, and each word in the sequence is either a non-terminal, an angled bracket, or it could be something that looks more like a plain string, like the plus symbol, or the minus symbol, or all these digits here. These symbols are called terminal symbols because the building of the tree is finished for such a symbol. It ends up as a leaf with no further nodes growing below it. The non-terminals, however, will be recursively replaced according to the grammar rules that have them on the left side. So when we derive, we're plugging these rules into each other. The blue symbols is defined as and or are called meta characters because they belong to the BNF itself, which is a meta language, a language to describe other languages. So cool. So we're describing a language by describing how to derive a tree. Okay, cool. The big question is, how do we actually start? How do we start to derive the tree based on our rules when we get the input string? Trees in computer science grow upside down, we know that, so we start somewhere at the top maybe. But our question is, what is the root symbol of the tree? What's the non-terminal symbol we start with? Our list of grammar rules is actually part of something bigger, a grammar notation called context-free grammars. So we need some more building blocks, but we know them all now. It's really cool. A context-free grammar consists of four things. A set of terminal symbols, which we've seen before, a set of non-terminal symbols, set of grammar rules, like we've seen before, sometimes they're also called productions, and then a start symbol, the last one, number four here. So all of these parts we know already, except for the start symbol, and that's what we were looking for, right? So what would it look like in our case? The terminal symbols we know already, plus, minus, zero, and so on, or the digits. The non-terminals are list and digit in our case. And then the grammar rules, they look a bit funny because on the left side of the rule, there must be a non-terminal, so it's list or digit. And on the right side of the rule, there could be a mix of terminals or non-terminals and then different alternatives of those. And then the start symbol in our case, it's just list. So somebody designated the start symbol. It's something we draw from the non-terminals, one of them. So we know already the terminal symbols are symbols of the input language, and the non-terminal symbols are structural symbols. So they are at the internal nodes of the tree. So we learn from these productions how to build the tree. And this notation looks somewhat similar to what state machines or automatons might look like from computer science, which you might have seen before. So we have a start state, and then we build a tree by applying rules to non-terminals. Non-terminals, not done yet. Until they're all gone, and we have a result tree where all the leaves are terminal symbols. A context-free grammar is more powerful than a regular expression, though. because it can keep track of nested structures, and it can express that for each opening bracket, for example, we need a closing bracket, so we can count in a way, if that makes sense. So we have the small grammar now and can express all sums and differences of one-digit numbers. Very useful. Do you see how we could make it express multiplication and division as well? How would you do that? We could add something to one of the rules, maybe? Do you see how we could make it express computations of numbers with more than one digit? Maybe we could add an extra rule for that? So it's a creative process to craft the right kind of grammar for your problem. For my little calculator problem, I can imagine everything. It's pretty easy. I can imagine what the extra clauses might look like, but it could be parsing an entire computer language, a programming language, I mean. So let's recall our goal. Why are we doing this? How can we turn this grammar into something that parses our input? So why did we end up with this grammar, and how can we use it, to say that in simple terms? So what's the relation? And we could say it's something like the yin and yang of cats. a parser and a grammar are two related dual concepts. So both are defining a language through what they can be used for, but they kind of come together. So a parser can be seen as an acceptor of a language. It accepts expressions of that language. So for example, 9 minus 5 plus 2 was something that the parser accepted, and it could reject expressions like 9 minus plus that are outside of that language. So we are defining a class here, stuff that's inside and that's outside. Accepted, rejected. And a grammar could be seen as a generator. So starting from the start symbol, we can derive all expressions of the language by following the grammar rules until no further derivation is possible. The language might be really big, so that we could never write down all of it. But the grammar gives us a compact way to describe all these possible parse trees at once. We could also say we describe the candidates of our parsing problem. What would they look like? Could be many of them. So it all comes together. When we destroy, we can create, and vice versa. When we have a grammar, we can generate a parser. And for parsers, we can work out a grammar to formalize them and specify the language, because there's lots of informal parsers hiding in your program. So how do we make a parser from our grammar? First of all, there are two ways. You could go top down and bottom up. Recursive top-down is the first possibility. So you would start from the start symbol and ask yourself the question, how can I derive a tree with the input at its leaves? The yield, right? Remember? So trying out all the rules and alternatives to derive the tree is a lot of work. We would have to write a long recursive program with one function for each rule to traverse all the rules and alternatives while consuming the input string and checking if the step of the derivation is successful or not. So that's the classical way to do it, but it's a lot of work. So I bet there's a YAC for that. YAC stands for yet another compiler compiler. A compiler compiler, that sounds really cool. Unfortunately, the original YAC is really old, so nowadays we should use its modern cousin. It's called GNU Bison. Or you could use something that's even more modern. I used JSON here. It's a clone in JavaScript, because I like JavaScript. our grammar for Bison could look something like this. So you see there are some rules here. There's a rule for list and expression. So I had to reformulate my grammar a little bit, because making it fit for the parser operator, you have to change the rules a bit. So here you also see we have a start symbol. So in my case, it's list. And then I have these expressions here for my plus and minus. But it's pretty similar to what we did before. And You can see also the alternatives. So they are separated by the bars, as we have seen before. And then you see something funny. You see these curly brackets. They seem to indicate what to do after parsing. So you can see that for the sum expression, this $$ equals $1 plus 3. Do you see that there? So the first and the third token are added for the final result. So something's happening here about what that means, what we just parsed. What are we going to do with it? So we're doing the addition here. And using the parser generator is very simple. You can see in this gray box here, it's just a command line tool. The hard part is getting the grammar right. So this really uses some head scratching, and it's you have to be creative and try things out. Because for the automatic generation to work, the grammar has to be only, it has to be unambiguous. So there has to be only one way to derive a certain parse tree. There can't be multiple ways going there. Then this automated method doesn't work. And that's also why I changed the rules a bit here. So that works. Instead of using a parser generator, we could also build our own parsers with combinators. With higher order functions. So what are higher order functions again? I think you all know this. They are functions with functions as arguments. In JavaScript, all these functions that take callbacks, for example, they are higher order functions because they take other functions. Or functions like map and filter on arrays in JavaScript, higher order functions because you can apply a function to each element of the array, for example. And there's a really nice publication about this combinator parsing, which is called Just Higher Order Functions for Parsing by Graham Hutton. So this is going to look a bit more theoretical. Some of you maybe were in the other lecture upstairs, the first lecture upstairs, where you already saw some Haskell code. So here we have a funny notation that you can sometimes see in functional programming languages. It's a way to write down the type of a function. Here, this function is called parser. It's a function from a list of symbols, so for example, a string, if the symbols are characters, to a result value. And the result value is a bit complicated. And that's because the parser not always consumes the entire string. So you could see the parser as a thing, it gets a string, it consumes a little bit of it, and then it spits out the rest. And then it also spits out what it parsed, which would be the B. The B would be something of type B, which is the parse result. And the A, list of A, would be the resulting input, which just gets passed on for further consumption for whatever happens after. So this seems to be a very general construct. Let's look at this in form of the symbolic drawing. So here you can see it, something called A is coming here. It could look like this. And then when this item A arrived, the parser goes green. Oh yeah, we could parse it into a B, and then it spits out the B and the rest of the A's. So it would look like this. And then how would we use this? How would we construct a parser? What would the parser look like? So what would the most simple parser look like in practice? What could be the most simple parser? How about a parser that's always happy and it's always successful? That would be nice. So the succeed parser, it always succeeds without consuming any input. If we look at this BNF form again and we think about the grammars, if you looked at these grammars sometimes, you will see that there's an empty string in there. So if you generated lots of symbols, you can end this row of productions and you just say, don't output anything here, we're done here. So the succeed parser would correspond to the empty string in BNF, which you use to end such a recursive derivation without adding any extra characters. So for example, if we would say succeed 5, it would succeed on any input and always return 5. So we have, in fact, two conditions for success. First of all, succeed means that a parsing step succeeded, and then we have the resulting string. So an empty resulting string means that the overall parse was successful. We parsed the entire string. We are done because we have nothing left to do. So it would like look like this. My input goes here, it succeeds, and I output my B. So that's pretty easy. And then the fail parser would be the opposite of this. So that would be a parser that always fails, no matter the input. It would have the type fail input returns empty list. So no matter what input we give it, it always returns the empty list as a result. So we could give it something, the input comes, but it's just always red, so we can just paint it red. Doesn't succeed. Get no return. So how do we make a parser that recognizes a symbol now? We can do that with a satisfy parser that tries to satisfy a predicate. So satisfy a predicate, when you get an empty input, you just return the fail. Because you can't really check that predicate there. And then satisfy a predicate for some longer list, x-axis, which is just a way to write a longer list in Haskell, which has more than one element. It would succeed if the predicate succeeds, and otherwise you also return fail. So you can make a decision here. Did I see an x, or didn't I see something like that? So from this you can create a parser which is called a literal parser. This is a parser for single symbols or literals. So you just do something like satisfy equals x. In the definition of literal parser, this equals x is a function that tests its argument for equality with x. So we can say we partially applied the infix operator equals. And partial application is also a fun trick from these functional languages. So it might look a bit strange if you didn't use this before. But you're just checking if something is x. So for example, if we would apply a parser literal 3 to the string 3, 4, 5, we would get the result 3 is our result type, and then 4, 5 would be the remaining string. So let's look at this. Here I did it with A and B again. So here you check, is this A equals X? And then you get something out of it, or you don't. So otherwise you would have the fail parser again. So now we have basic parsers to parse some literals. For our language, the literals are plus, minus, 0 to 9, all the digits. These were the terminals of our grammar, right? We also call these parsers terminal parsers now because they parse terminal symbols, if that makes sense. So these are our basic parsers, our basic building blocks. But how can we put these terminal parsers together to build some useful parser? I just don't want to parse always just one character. So this we can do with parser combinators. And as we have heard already this morning, combinators or combining forms are functions that take two things and or more and make something of the new type again, of the same type again. So they're taking two parsers and creating a new parser that does something different. So here's what it could look like. My way of drawing it. So I put in two parsers, parser A, parser B, and then I'm making some parser C out of it with the combinator. I don't know what the combinator is like now, what it is now. And parser C just acts like any other parser. So it's consuming some input, and it's spitting out some rest of the input and the parse result, like we have seen it before. So the whole big box is a parser C again. What I don't know is what it's wired like inside, and that's what we're going to look at now. So the alternative combinator is the first combinator we're going to look at. And it combines two parsers, P1 and P2, to a new parser, P3. And the new parser, P3, recognizes everything that either P1 or P2 would. And this is an inclusive OR. So we're just putting it all together in one bag. And in general, a parser returns an arbitrary number of results. And that's really good for us because we picked return lists, so we can put many results in there. We're returning a list. So this is the definition of the alternative combinator in some Haskell-type syntax. And we can see here that it's implemented by concatenating the results of both individual parsers. So if I write something like P1 inp here, it means I'm applying the parser 1 to the input. And then I'm applying parser 2 to the input, and I'm concatenating the two. So this plus plus is just the list concatenation in Haskell. So I'm concatenating all the individual parse results, if that makes sense. And the alternative combinator has the expected behavior if one of the parsers fail, because it will then return an empty list there. And also it inherits associativity from the concatenation operator, just from the plus plus. And allowing multiple results allows us to parse ambiguous grammars as well, where more than one derivation path would lead to one and the same parse tree. The alternative combinator combines two parsers P1 and P2 to a new parser P3 again, but this one, let's look at this in the example. Sorry. So what we just saw here. So I'm putting in my ABCD here, and I have these two parsers, literal A and literal B, which I put into the alternative operator combinator. So I'm giving my input to both actually. And because it was ABCD, I can parse literal A from it, and this one succeeds. So I get my BCD out of it, but this literal B, it fails. It didn't produce any results. So you have to imagine this would have given me the empty list, and both of them would have been concatenated. Okay, so I was a bit too fast, sorry. This is the next combinator. So the next combinator is also called the next combinator. And it corresponds to writing things in sequence in BNF. So if we would write in BNF again, we wouldn't even see this combinator. It wouldn't be there. We would just write words in sequence on the right side of a rule next to each other, and it would be implicitly there. And again, this parser P1 next P2 recognizes everything that P1 and P2 would, but if they were placed in succession. Now that's the important difference. So how would this be implemented? I have to torment you with Haskell syntax again. I'm sorry, it's almost the last time. So if you look at its implementation, we have a very strange notation again, because this is an excellent example of the list comprehension notation. Another interesting construct from functional languages. It works a bit like the set comprehension we know from math. So from your math classes, you might remember it. So if you would replace these square brackets here by curly brackets, you could imagine it as constructing a set, maybe. And since the first parser might succeed with many results, that's always possible, and all of these might have different remaining input strings, the second parser must be applied to each of these input strings we get from that step. And that's why we have this, we feed it in there again. So we get the rest of the input again, and then the output, and then we feed that in there again. So output one is fed in parser 2, if that makes sense. So we have to combine them all. That's what this list comprehension here does really nicely. We could say this process maybe has some similarities to function composition because parsers are applied in sequence here, but it's a bit different. So if we think about an example, we could do something like the parser literal A and then next literal B. These tilde tilde are the next combinator for me. And I apply this to the input A, B, C, D. So what would I get? I would get A and B separate and then C, D, which would be the rest, which isn't parsed yet. And sequencing is not associative because I use these tuples to express the results. So let's look at this in the diagram again. How are the parsers applied in succession? So my input is arriving here, and then it can be parsed for the A, so this gets cut off. My BCD is my remaining input, which moves on to my next parser in succession. And I already have my A ready, and now I have my B ready too, and I get the overall result of CD. So the using combinator is the last combinator we're going to talk about today. And the using combinator has no counterpart in BNF, but we see it when writing grammars for parser generators like Yak or GNU Bison, which we've seen before. So there you saw these curly brackets. So this might be something that's related to this. Because there we could add something in brackets behind the grammar rules and we could indicate an action that should be performed after the parsing. So we could say, add these two numbers that I parsed here together to get the result. Or if we parse a really long keyword, we could like transform it to a shorter operator, for example. Things like this we could do on this level. And it's implemented as just applying the function f to the parse result of parser p. So you can see here this p using f. F is just a function application. And you can see in the resulting tuple, it's applied to the parse result. So in the diagram, we get our input, but also a function f of x would be like this. And then when my parser works, it gets my parse result A, for example, because I did this literal A and I had ABC, ABCD, and then it applies this function F around it. And then I'm done. So even though our parse tree is the natural output of the parser, this tree doesn't have to be our final result. So we don't have to end here. I mean, it's interesting to look at, but that's not all of it. And with the using combinator, we can apply any kind of semantic action. Remember that syntax was the form of a computer program and semantics is the meaning of the program. So we're crossing this line here, which is really interesting. We can do some evaluation and give it a meaning. So if we parse the sum term in the grammar rule, we might want to apply the addition function to the parse result afterwards. If we parse a difference, we might want to apply the subtraction function, and so on. So this could be seen like an evaluation step of our parse tree. It could mean evaluating our arithmetic expression from the example, which would just give us 6, or it could mean evaluating a computer program or some parsed user input. And then we act on it. And with the using combinator, we can apply functions to each internal node, and in this way, evaluate the parse expression. We could say the tree disappears in the process, and for our arithmetic expression, we get a result value, like for example, 6 here. So if we would think back to our BNF grammar, this could be a parser now. So let's have a look. We just have to replace the plus, minus, and digit for terminal parsers here. I'm not doing it because it didn't really fit on the slide. but you can imagine what I'm doing. And the next combinators on the right side of the rule, I would have to write, so I would have to write between this list and the plus and the digit. I would have to write the next combinators, the tildes. And the alternative combinators, I had to write with the three bars to get my combinator. And boom, we could do combinator parsing. This is it. It's all defined. We're ready to go. So we have seen that we can implement all the terminal parsers and parser combinators that we need by hand. But also, there's a really cool library to play with this again. And it's in JavaScript. It's called Parsimon. It's written in JavaScript, and you can find it on GitHub. And it has a lot of useful things already in it that we don't have to write all the terminal parsers, for example. So you will see, when you play with this a bit, you will see that the alternative combinator is called alt. The next combinator is called seq, like sequence. And all of them look like boring old functions, because not as cool as Haskell, where you can use them as operators. But we're OK with that. And apart from that, you can build your own rules, like you're used to from BNF again. And this time, the grammar itself is the parser. So let's just remember the few constructs we just learned. I mean, it's really not that many constructs. It fits good on one slide really well. So the building blocks we needed are all the terminal parsers, which would look something like this literal hello or whatever, my keyword of my language, or a digit, something like that. And then the combinators to combine them. And the most important combinators are this next combinator, alternative combinator, and the using combinator. And that's all. You can devise more complicated ones, but you can build it all from this. And that's it already. So thank you so much for listening. This talk is somewhat experimental, as you might have noticed. I started it because of Igor, who will speak after me, about Minikanren and Quines. And both talks are drawing from the same publication. And we got really crazy about reading this publication and figuring out how this all works. And that's why I would like to close with a call of action for all of you. Read these computer science publications of the 60s and 70s, and maybe this one from 1985. First of all, it's actually not that much work back in the day. I mean, it's still, you can find out the best stuff. It's less volume than nowadays because it's a new field in that time. But at the same time, there are some really delicious pieces of literature from that era. And I suggest that you always share this love on Twitter, like if you find some cool publications about computer science. And because we are in the future here, most of these techniques that you will discover, they're already implemented in JavaScript, and they're there for you to explore. Thanks for listening. So, questions?
Test. Hi. First of all, thanks for the talk. Uh-huh. I have kind of maybe a primitive question. But in the example of the subtraction, is the, for example, the subtraction implemented using a using combinator that will actually do the subtraction and then maybe pass that node structure on, and then other parsers would go and do the rest, like maybe an addition application?
Yes, yes, you could totally do that. You could totally implement the action with the using combinator and then get the overall evaluated result back. But that's also up to you. I mean, you could pretty print the result, you could compute it, you could do some kind of optimization about it. All these things that you plug in with this using combinator could be completely different depending on the problem that you have. So you could have some long debug trace if you want to know, like, how did I get the six? Or you could just compute the six.
And if I wanted to learn a little bit more about the basics, maybe is this a white paper? Maybe the paper isn't the most accessible form. Is there a more simple, like, Fisher Price, My First Combinators resource?
I think that would be Parsimon, honestly. I think it's really well written. I found it super understandable. It didn't take me a long time to understand how they are doing it. But if you read that together with some really nice paper about this, like for example this Graham Hutton, higher order functions for parsing, if you are familiar with Haskell, you can read that. If not, it might be difficult. I think then you will understand it, because this library is just super fun to work with. It's very educational.
All right, thank you.
Thanks for the talk. You were in the beginning of your talk talking about there are grammars and parsers hidden in our code. Could you give some examples what you have seen in your own code?
So I think this is a very simple example, the calculator, because that's an example that fits on a slide really well. But what you see in everyday coding. So I worked in bioinformatics before I worked at Etsy, for example, and people. All the time they had different formats, and then you had to parse the format, and it wasn't really clear how it's specified, so the parser kind of specifies your behavior, and then you have to feed this format into another tool, but it's the same data, it's just everybody expresses it a bit differently. And that's why it's such an everyday problem, that it could be just your user input, somebody giving you on command line how they want to use your program. You might have to parse that. I mean, there are libraries for that, but yeah, mostly converting data into different formats. We see it all around us.
So outside of an academic context, is how could you actually use this day to day? Because I was thinking maybe, you know, the big thing now is like natural language processing. Like when you say to someone like Airbnb, like, I want to book a room, you know, arriving Sunday morning, leaving this state in this place. Is this, would you use a parser to do that, for example?
So I think for natural languages, the state of the art, I mean, that's not my field of research, but I think the state of the art is to use something that takes statistics in mind as well. So you would have some grammar maybe like this, but it would have statistic rules. So it would say with the probability of, I don't know, 0.2, take this rule, and with the probability of that, take that rule, and so on. So it would model in some way how often do these different rules appear in reality. So you would have to add that factor, but you could build on this. More questions? No more questions? Wave. Yeah, if you don't have any more questions, you can find me after. Thank you again.